We were going to do three rounds today. The first round was the article about Aristotle and international political leadership. The second article was women's rights, the paper on women's rights that quoted from Mary Wollstonecraft and Martha Nussbaum. And the third round is on John Stuart Mill, the outline of his book, The Subjection of Women. So, comments. I will first take comments, then summarize the article, then take further comments for each one, just to try and keep a dialogue going. If you have questions for another student when they make that first comment, go ahead. All right, Titus, let's start with you. The article on Aristotle capabilities model today. Unmute yourself.
My bad. That's the one about the life, bodily health, integrity, or is that the one talking about?
Both of them start out with the capabilities model. One of them, okay. Both of them start out. One of them is about political leadership, and then the other one is about women's rights. So first is political.
All right. So the political one, if I can find it. Let's see, just to be sure, this was, America signed off on this, right? Well, one of the nations that signed off on it, and it was in 1948,
45? Yeah, right. Well, no, probably 48. It was soon after World War II.
Right, and let's see, and one of those articles, I'm pretty sure it talked about having any slaves, right? Not having any slaves.
Oh, that wasn't an article. That was just the Declaration of Human Rights, but
okay. Right. So I just found that weird since I'm pretty sure slavery didn't actually end until about around 1960s. I'm not sure about.
In what country? In what country? The U.S.?
I'm pretty sure it was
19.
I'm tripping.
Yeah. Okay.
But for it to be a huge gap between that and when they signed it.
They signed it in 1945. So
right.
Officially, I don't think officially people had slaves. I don't think it was a respected legal institution. There's a lot of other hypocrisy among the people who sign it. So you could have picked some other stuff. But anyway, so that was not what I meant. I meant the article about governance, right? You had to read some stuff.
Let me see.
Okay, I'll just go to Mary Hannah. There were two papers for you to read. Mary Hannah, did you read that paper?
Yes, ma'am. This was the Articles in Human Capabilities one.
Right.
Okay. So the first point I made was about bodily integrity, and I agreed. But then I had the question of, like, is this saying, like, abortions okay? Like, is this representing?
Wait. Okay. So you haven't got the right article. Let me get it.
Oh, gosh. Okay.
Okay. The right article is Aristotle UN capabilities, right? The synthesis of ancient, modern, and postmodern paradigms. Okay, so when I ask you to read a paper, that's a paper. And the UN Declaration is a list. It's not a paper. Okay, let's start again. It gets handy that the thing you thought it was a lot easier than the thing that was. Okay, so the other thing I decided that I'm going to have to ask you is to write how long it took you to do the assignments and do the post, because And you have to tell me that you read the material, because I said in the pre-video that I cannot tell from some of your reactions if you actually read it. So you do have to prove to me, right, that you've read it. Okay, so Mary Hannah, the bodily integrity was the one on women's rights, right? That was where it was emphasized more. So why don't you go to the Aristotle one for starters?
Okay, it's gonna take me a minute to find those notes. I have them organized, but if someone else can go real quick.
Okay, so Akaya?
I talked about something that was said in the paper. I really didn't have much to say on this particular paper, but one of the sentences said, Aristotle's Ethics in Politics provides a model of how the citizens of any nation, particularly those who inherit power and privilege, must be raised so that they will be willing and able to use their power wisely. And I just thought that stuck out to me because you see people nowadays misusing their power, like in like politics, like for instance, Donald Trump, people, they might like pay their way out of something. You hear about a lot of scandals about like people paying their way through like college or people scamming people or like politics just corrupting people. So I just feel like the use of Aristotle's ethics in politics are not being used like they should be today in today's age. So
anybody else want to comment or ask her a question or pick up from that? I would say greed. Okay, Akaya. It's people were buying their way in the kids, their children to get into good colleges, right? And people buy good lawyers to get out of, okay. So I think behind it, there's money. And then the politicians are campaigns, okay? Rich people pay for the campaigns. Whoever has the most money wins the elections because people don't look more broadly. They just turn on the ads and, you know, go according to which people have the best advertisements, which means the most money. And then once they get to be leaders, the rich who got them the position tell them what laws to make and what not to make in ways that will further make them richer. Okay, Akaya, does that make sense? I mean, we have to make sure we have a political system and we have an economic system. And we have to figure out what's the connection and how can you tell a decent politician from a puppet of the rich, right? It's really important. Did you think the main, I mean, you got a sentence that is pretty much the main thesis of the paper. So that's great. Can you think of, yeah, okay. And then you thought of an example. So that's fine. Very good. I hope that then you can take it, keep expanding that, right? Okay, good. Caitlin.
So really one of the things I thought was interesting was how, like I know it was capabilities. It was just how, like, when individuals are given the opportunities to make the society better, it, like, increases the opportunities for middle class and for a good democracy. So without the capabilities and the opportunities, then with, like, equal to all people, then there's no way that we can have, like, a good middle class and democracy.
Right. And that's where the arguments come in politics. There's equality of desert and equality of opportunity. Equality of desert is I worked hard, I started a business, I made money, you're stealing my profits if you tax me, right? Equality of opportunity is that we've got to get everybody at a level table when they apply for a job or when they apply for a loan to start a business. So we have to have public education, basic public health care. So people have the opportunity, or they can, they have to have the opportunity to get a good job. In order to do that, they've got to have a good education and decent health care. Does that make sense? And then, yeah. Okay, but you have to tax people. So that's a major issue, and that will always be a major issue. Equality of desert, I get what I worked for. Equality of opportunity, I need the education so I can actually get the job and then work to prosper, right? All right, Michael.
Okay, so one of the quotes that I pulled was, political leaders need to explain to the public why a certain agreement is most likely to lead to overall human flourishing for every citizen into the future. And I personally feel like we don't get that a lot when we're pulled out of the Paris Agreement. Yeah, I don't know. That was confusing. Anyway, but I also feel like on the flip side, I feel like that a lot of people need to be willing to listen. I think that that's also, I think it's a very like two-sided issue and not just from the political leader, but also from the public.
Very good. Anybody want to comment?
Michael, you said we got pulled out of what? What was that you said? I couldn't.
The Paris Agreement. I think agreement is that the.
Yep, that's what it's called. Yeah.
Like it has to do with climate change.
Is that the environmental one? That one?
Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
Yeah. Actually, how many of you has it occurred to you that you get the politicians you deserve? You know. Politicians will do what they need to do to get elected. And if polarizing, you know, demonizing works, if that works, they'll do it. And so you can't say, oh, I hate my politicians because they polarize. They wouldn't do it if it didn't work. So, and then you can say, yeah, but advertising just molds people to look for that. And then you say, but you don't have to pay attention to advertising. You shouldn't, right? That shouldn't be how you decide who to vote for, right? So that's the dynamic. And the philosopher just says, use your mind, guys. Get over it. All right. Anybody else want to ask Michael or comment? Okay, Lekesny, what about you?
The thing, what I got from the article was how the UN, for the people in the UN, how they kind of put everybody on common ground, like the rich and the poor, to like the ground of them being like elected, like they get for the rich, they kind of didn't give them much opportunity, so their money would carry them a longer way than the poor. For the poor, they gave them more opportunities for.
Yeah, redistribute wealth, right?
Yeah.
And opportunity, those go together. How much did you know about the UN?
Not much.
Okay, I do think you should know more about it. because if you don't know much, then whenever there's a war, a number of our political leaders will demonize the UN just instantly. It's rotten. And if the public doesn't know what the UN actually does, they'll believe it. Okay. So there's the Security Council, Russia, China, the US, France, and Britain. That again, that comes from 1945. It's pretty dated. But when it comes to wars, the UN is not effective because powerful countries, particularly the US, doesn't pay any attention to them, right? It's not their fault. But the UN does so many other things. So they have a World Heritage Fund. So they protect natural sites and cultural sites that are World Heritage sites, but that exist in poor countries, right? The countries cannot afford to maintain them, all right? That's one thing. Then they have all this, the Children's Emergency Fund. They have a lot of programs for well-being. And then smaller countries, this is their one place in the world. So they will have on their number one newspaper in their country on the front page, they will have what the UN did that day, because that is their way of participating in international politics. But Americans are incredibly ignorant about it. So I do think there's a reason for that. You're getting brainwashed, guys. So, you know, you'd be better off knowing about it. You do have to think, just in general, the educational system has an agenda. And then you have to think about what's the agenda and how do I get around that agenda? Well, you could say, why are we reading Aristotle? I understand, right? That's a Western agenda. I don't think the way I teach it is, but definitely I know a lot of people in my field and they are really, some days you don't want to ask them how far into Western superiority they actually are, which is totally wrong. But anyway, I understand the corruption of it, but I think the way I apply it and teach it should make it hopefully clear that I've pulled it out of Aristotle's context and brought it into the 21st century. Jason.
So there is these two sentences that stuck out to me a lot. It says that not everyone can create laws that lead to the possible political association in a particular nation at a particular time. Not everyone can listen to conflicting points of view and come up with a resolution that is truly in the interest of everyone, or can distinguish between what is best in theory and what is best in a particular situation. I think that stuck out to me a lot because you were mentioning it before. Like, it seems now that is, if not probably like the most polarizing it's ever been. It always seems like the left is demonizing the right for this. The right is demonizing the left for this. It's like, there's never a time where you can like, you hop on the news and you get on and someone's getting criticized for doing this or doing that. It's always like, oh, every time, it's almost as like every time you get on the TV, something negative about the other side is doing something. It's almost like the media is always, something always is always negative whenever you get on TV. I don't know, maybe that's just me, but I think like, especially now with everything that's going on, it's like probably the most polarizing it's ever been. But like I said, I think that's probably just me.
No, that's what history will say, right? So the question is, do you like that? And do you want that moving forward? Right, and if you don't like it and you don't want it, you're in college now, you have to be the beginning of the problem, right? Once you get to college, you're intellectually developed enough to take responsibility, right? And to start making change. I think in high school, I don't know about you, but you just feel like there's so much you can't control and you're somebody's daughter and somebody's sister and you live in a, you know, all this stuff. But when you come to college, especially Lyon, where you go to a residential, you can really decide for yourself, right? The other thing I'd be careful about is, you know, when somebody is critical of a political leader, are they using facts or are they just using labels? And then you have to find out, where can I find articles or people that will start with facts and draw conclusions, right? So please do. I mean, you can go on to Fox and Tucker Carlson and find out why he isn't respected. Like, what does he say, right? And how many facts does he use? And how many labels does he use, right? I mean, how often do you hear the radical left? Okay, so how many liberals do you hear saying the radical right, right? And then you have to figure out, is it data-based? Is it evidence-based? I think you can find this stuff, but you know, you have to look, you have to, that's why, again, I said with the cabinets, those are just facts. You could draw a lot of inferences from those facts. But I don't want to say where I go to get it because it's too polarizing, right? And also when I listen for the difference between opinions and facts because I teach logic, right? So, but, you know, if anybody wants to talk about it, or I had a student who said she wanted to have a reading group to discuss some of these issues. Well, I created a reading group. I read a bunch of books. I don't know, 1,500 pages worth of books. And I scanned some of the highlights. And I can just put you on that reading group and you can look at any of that stuff you want to. But again, I want to stay hands off on that. And just what you learn is logic. And then you have to sort of go in the world and figure it out. But anyway, I think you picked one of my favorite paragraphs. I was going to mention that, Jason, that we trivialize practical wisdom. And then when you realize how many skills it takes, then we call someone an elitist, right? Because somebody thinks somebody is actually a lot better than this than somebody else. Well, then you're an elitist, right, Jason? Does that make sense? When actually this stuff is really hard to figure out what sort of laws and policies to have. And I know when I hear somebody talking about it, I listen for who has a good argument and who doesn't. But again, I'm older, so I've heard a lot of that stuff. But at least that's something to look for. Do other people understand why I said it gets accused of being elitist, but I don't think it is. It's just like, if you're gonna fly an airplane, you have to know a lot of stuff. You're not gonna just vote for whoever you think should fly the airplane, right? But our lives are at stake in who we choose to rule us. Our lives, our well-being, our health, all that stuff is really at stake, and yet we trivialize it. Well, so thanks, Jason. I think you picked up something really good. Any other comment you want to make?
Yeah, could you kind of like elaborate on the elitist part? I'm kind of understanding where you're getting at, but kind of not. Like, are you saying like cause you mentioned the pilot? Like, did you mention it? I don't know. Okay.
Well, yeah, I did. Like right. A pilot, he has to go to school and he has to know stuff.
Right. So
you don't get to vote on who gets to fly the airplane according to who has the better commercials, you know, or the better rhetoric, right? Right. So how come with political leadership, when people have so much power, we just vote based on their rhetoric?
I think it's it falls into I know there's a phrase for it, but it's like what is it? How likable that person is, like how
I know, and that shouldn't have anything to do with it.
Right. I think that's kind of, I guess, I don't know, maybe for most voters, it probably outweighs all everything else, because like people want to, like, I guess at a certain level want to be able to relate to that person. So it's kind of, there's the, it says like how like likable is that person if you were to sit down and have a beer with that person.
I think right. Mm-hmm. Except that person has developed this persona.
Right.
Right. It has nothing to do with who they really are. It's like a Facebook brand, right? I mean, really. And it doesn't have anything to do with their ability to know how to make good policy, their ability to know who to appoint in the cabinet, their ability to listen to specialists and to adjust their point of view according to the specialist. There's layers and layers of stuff that they really need to do. They need to be humble. They need to know somebody else knows more than I do. Anyway, I mean, I could go on and on, but it's just sad that most Americans don't know what the job is, and they don't know what skills you need to do the job.
Right. So like being an elitist, that like I guess I just seen, I skimmed over it, but some people said that Aristotle was elitist and that makes him like anti-democratic, but I don't see how that kind of makes you anti-democratic, because like you said, there's a lot of layers to the there's certain stuff. You just don't want a random guy flying your airplane, your 747 Boeing, to Hawaii or wherever you're going, because you know you might not make it there, you might not even make it off the runway. So I don't see how that's kind of anti-democratic. Maybe
You ever heard people saying so-and-so is an elite?
Yeah, right?
That right. Means they don't care about you, and that's not true, right? The people who could really help form a middle class are among the best and the brightest. Does that make sense, Jason?
Yeah.
Okay. So just remember, the next time somebody says, oh, they're elite, you know, just say, wait a sec. Are they doing it for the sake of the well-being of people? Are they just? Or are they elitist in the sense that they're rich and they do not care about you or anybody except themselves, right?
Right. I think now it's whenever someone mentions elitist, it's always like they're talking about that top 1%. You know, your Bill Gates, your Jeff Bezos, all those other people, Warren Buffett. I think that's they're talking about them, but there's probably, you know, that other part of the elitists that you mentioned that actually, you know, they're trying to build that middle class, and you know, because they always talk about like making the rich poor, but I don't know if that's going to solve anything. It's rather bringing up from the bottom up, kind of working from like the poor class, making them maybe like being more accessible to the middle class instead of having
right.
To,
but how do you? Who pays for the programs to give them the opportunities, right?
Yeah,
either rich folk that structure the programs or else taxes. And also there are two classes of billionaires. The Bill Gates, Warren Buffett billionaires want to be carbon neutral by 2030, and they work on development, like the other school that I'm teaching at gets Gates Foundation money, right? Because they want to promote women. The other group of elites are fossil fuel-based billionaires who do not want the system to change, okay? They are fundamentally different. And you can call them both elites, but you know, I think one is ruling for the benefit of the ruled and one is ruling for themselves, right? But again, you know, I read like 1,000 pages about some of these people finally during COVID, so that because I had a suspicion and I heard stuff, but I just needed to read it and find out for myself. So if people want it, I wish I could just tell you a site to go to that wouldn't be polarizing, but I can't. I don't know of any site that wouldn't punch somebody's button. And so I can't do that. All right, so let's go. I mean, I do think you all hit on some of the main issues. Rule for the sake of the ruled. One other thing is that it's too idealistic. It's not idealistic. You do it all the time. Is it too idealistic to say a parent could actually care about the well-being of their children? What if they don't, right? And then it's not idealistic to say they make mistakes. You know, Aristotle says it's so complicated, and Greek art is about tragedy when people think they're doing the right thing. So that's how you get educated, right? And that's what we actually talk about day in and day out, right? Too much, too little, the mean. Are you sure you're doing the right thing? What about this? That's what we do. So it's really idealistic to think that you should raise your kids to make as much money as possible, and that's success, and think that the society is going to remain stable and flourishing. That is pie in the sky. Does everybody understand that? I just hate the way these words have gotten completely flipped. I would say one is common sense and the other one is just completely off the wall. Michael?
You made like a comment about raising your children and it reminded me of part of the reading. And essentially the gist was like, talking about parents raising their children to not underachieve, but also not overachieve. And the overachieve thing kind of, I don't know that it like rubbed me the wrong way, but essentially the way it was written in my perspective is that, you know, the parents themselves kind of decide the top of, you know, where they plateau, you know what I mean? And obviously I've never had a child, so I don't have the perspective from a parent, but I just wasn't really, I don't know. I didn't like that part of the reading for sure.
That parents, it assumes parents actually have some say in that, or?
It was, one second, I can find it.
Probably. What I'm getting at is that, a kid might really like to teach, even though it doesn't make money. And if the parents think they really need to do something to make money, then they, or when parents let their kids inherit their business, even when the kid has no, well, I mean, Mr. Tyson, for example, had been a drug addict, but he inherited Tyson Foods and he wasn't very good at it either. That would be overachieved. Like, if parents think the ultimate success as a parent is to have a kid that has power or money, a kid will get in a situation they don't know how to handle. And the people who work for them know that they're smarter and better and have more wisdom than their boss. And the boss just got in for some other reason. Does that make sense, Michael?
Yes, yes, it does.
Okay. Is that how you read it or not? Or were you thinking?
No, I read it in the aspect of like, in some ways, I feel like the parent could, you know, not allow the child to achieve something greater that they could achieve, if that makes sense. But I do understand what you're saying in the sense, yeah.
No, if it's a sense of calling, if it's a talent, developing a talent, they should go for it. But if it's just based on power and money, right?
Right, but I think that like contextually overachieve, which is the word that they use, doesn't necessarily have to mean power and money. And, you know, you can overachieve in teaching. I don't think that like, I think that like, you know, I've definitely had professors who were just much better professors and people than others. And I feel like there's overachieving within your career, but
Well, that's not overachieving. Doing your job well isn't overachieving, right? Does that make sense?
is doing it well.
That's all I meant. It means doing it well. So I guess actually, yeah, I guess that word has to refer to that you're just aiming for status and money and power instead right. of, yeah, okay. So yeah, it's a bad word. Yep. I'd say, yeah.
I can kind of, well, I've heard a lot of stories about this when it relates to the field of athletics, for example, like if a child wants to do something academic, say become a professor or some type of lawyer, but he's like 6'7", their parents kind of force them to play sports like basketball or maybe even football if they're big. And only because it leads to more money, per se. So I guess that's the way I kind of, it reminded me of when you said overachieving parents.
Okay. Or they're ambitious for their kids. Yeah, okay. They want them to be more successful than they're really capable of. Something like that.
Yeah, but really it's about, for some parents, it's more about the money than the actual success itself.
That's too bad. Jason?
I guess it's just a question for everybody. Is it bad for parents to want to be ambitious for their child, or should they like not even have a hand in how like and what they like, you know, what they want to do, what they want to accomplish? Or is that okay? Is it just natural for parents? Is that like a parent thing to do, or?
I think it depends on what their goals are. Like if it's in favor of the child, then yes. But if it's just for greed, like trying to make the child do something he or she really isn't interested in because of what you think they should be or because what you want them to be, then no.
Or it would make you look good to the neighbors, right? I don't know. Some people, they would rather have their kid be a lawyer because that's status than a teacher, or a doctor because that's their idea of status. I don't know. Anyway, but the general idea is that you should let the kid find out what they enjoy doing that makes a contribution. And then, you know, they should develop that ability. They shouldn't be lazy, right? But anyway, okay, let's go to the next one, women's rights, right? This time I have an outline, so I'll put the outline up there. And you guys, shall we start with a woman here? Caitlin, go ahead.
I think we should start with the male.
Okay. Anybody want to volunteer? We have the same capabilities and then we apply it to women. All right. Let's see. Lekesny, you want to go? What?
Not first.
You don't want to go first. All right, Jason.
Is this the list one?
No, it's the one about women. No, it's not the list, not the declaration. It's a paper.
Human functional capabilities, that one?
It was called Philosophy, Feminism, the Development of International Culture.
Oh, okay. Let me pull it up real quick.
The main thesis was people think that ideas are not powerful. So the capability of practical reason. All right. So you have these capabilities. life. Well, everybody knows if you're alive or dead, right? And if you're healthy, and if you, you know, have the right to protect yourself from rape, that's pretty obvious. Senses, imagination, emotions. Then you have this weird one, being able to form a conception of the good and engage in critical reflection about the planning of your life. So that looks like too abstract, right? Let's get back to friendships, you know, animals, something concrete. So the argument is actually this drives everything. Because when people think women are incapable of complete reason, then they are denied every other capability. They're educated less. Sometimes they're fed less, right? They're cared for less. So that's the main thesis of the paper. Okay. So, Jason.
Yes, ma'am.
You have a reaction?
No, not really.
Okay, so I'll go to someone. You can just say pass for now, right? Yeah. Pass for now. Okay. Let's see. Titus.
I for the most part agree because, like, for example, well, for my personal experience, I can't say there are any women I know that does not lack the ability to for reasonable thought and ideas. Actually, most of them I know have a much higher GPA than I do. So, and their potential is much greater. So there's no way I'd actually sell one short.
Yeah, but that was because somebody changed their mind about women and they changed the institutions and the laws and the, right, the culture. And that's how you know that, because John Stuart Mill in his day, people would say, I never met a woman who cared about politics. Of course they shouldn't vote, right?
Probably because they didn't ask either.
Well, and also because they were never taught anything about politics, right? If you don't talk to people about stuff and let them read stuff and let them get engaged, they don't know very much.
I feel like it works both ways as far as if you're uneducated, then you won't know. It doesn't really matter if you're a man or a woman. It just depends on how much you know.
Yeah, and opportunity, right? And motivation, all that stuff. What about, let's see, who else is here? Michael, we're doing all the guys first, is that right? Caitlin, then you can go. Okay, Michael.
Just one second, sorry. One of the quotes I pulled was when you said it was something just about like the idea of like promoting women's equality was both revolutionary and mundane. And I just thought that, like, I don't know. I just thought that was like a really, like, and then you talked more about that. But I thought that was a really, like, it's not good that promoting women's equality is revolutionary, but I thought it was a really great idea in general. And then just like on a more broad sense, this just kind of made me think about my privilege as a man. And I mean, more specifically a white man. Other than that, I didn't have any other big points.
Oh, but that's a good thing to realize, right? The things that you have that you just take for granted. The thing about your first comment is, my gosh, you can read stuff 2,000 years old and they're making the same arguments, right?
Right.
It just gets a little old, but that's the power of habituation. If you grow up getting habituated to be inferior and yet genetically you're not, there's just So there's always going to be some spokesperson that will speak out, but then it will get lost again and found again. And okay, so Caitlin, go ahead.
Okay, so I kind of I agree with what Tata said about how it doesn't depend like on if you're male or female. Like if you're educated, then you can make good decisions. But I also like going off of that, it said deny women, it's probably brought on the page, but deny more responsibility for their actions because they don't know any better. And I just thought that was really interesting that even when it came to like morals, like the uneducatedness was excused or not like, I don't know. That just was weird to me because I feel like morals and like is different compared to like education wise. I feel like people should have morals whether there's education or not. And then it was, they don't know any better. So I don't really know.
Well, you could put women, people used to put women on a pedestal. She's so perfect. She shouldn't get involved in politics and economics. That's just sort of dirty stuff. I want her to be perfect and she can go take care of the house and I'll be the good provider. But that's actually a put down, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, who else? Let's see, Marihanna. Mary Hannah.
Okay. So I guess now I could bring up the whole bodily integrity thing. I think that's a big one because I feel like a lot of women get like, body shamed. I don't know the right word. Judged. It's like a big thing for women. I think everybody will know what I'm talking about. But I feel like it kind of, people judge you like your personalities, not just you, but also your personalities by your body. And that's a big trait for a woman, I feel like. But then also, I gotta find, I had the quote. Oh, religion. I wanted to bring up religion. So like comparing then to now, I just remember growing up and I have friends that are like Church of Christ, like now, and they're just very against like women speaking out in church. And I'm Methodist to where now, like, women can speak out to church. And, like, this was talk a lot of people. We have a woman preacher who I love. Like, I think she's great. But then I went to that church, and they were, like, about to sing. And they're, like, someone lead the prayer or, like, lead the song. And it's, like, all the women had to still sit and wait for if there's a man in the room, the man still had to do it. And that, I guess, was probably brought about in church a long time ago, but I guess, and now in some churches, that just like amazed me because I was like, so you're saying a man is more, has more like honor or whatever to talk about God than I do? Like that just was one point.
Yeah, and there's, it's not evidence-based, right? It's faith-based. And, you can pick quotes in the Bible, but Jesus treated women as equals. So yeah, it annoys me because who are you gonna believe, Paul or Jesus? Who are you gonna believe, the Old Testament or Jesus? I mean, yeah, whatever. Okay, so let's see, who else? Akaya.
So I was, the emotions on the capabilities model, it stuck out to me because on the outline when it had talked about marriage and it should be based on friendship first, not sexual attraction. Going back off of what Caitlin said and the whole morals thing, I agree, like you, I feel like you, it doesn't really depend on how you're being like educated or not educated. I just feel like you should be able to have respect for yourself to get to know somebody before you just say, oh, I want to marry them because of their sex is good, instead of saying, oh, I want to marry them because we're connected and we can bond, if that makes sense.
Of course. So sexual attraction is often the trigger, but really you have to think about, do I really want to live with this person the rest of my life? Do I want them to be the parent of my child, right? And so I do think people need to link their emotions to their reason. Does that make sense? And okay, so the other thing she was saying, go ahead. Somebody else want to comment?
You guys, I want to make a comment about that. I feel like that's not like the text said about man and woman. I feel like women do the same thing. Like,
okay. Okay, friendships with benefits.
Yeah, but I feel like it's not one-sided. Well, I don't know about it. Used to be, I wasn't alive or old enough to realize, but I feel like women do things off of attraction or only attraction as well. I know plenty of people that are
doing. Well, I mean, literally that's changed over time, right? But I do think it's sad when feminism means I can split mind and body just as well as you can. You know, I mean, really? Okay, I guess so. I can be just as greedy as men. I can be just as power hungry. I can be just as, you know, wicked. That wasn't the original idea. All right. So the religion thing is important because if anybody wants to comment on this, whenever there is, okay, so the Methodists did ordain women way before these other churches did. I think it was very early 1900s. I think they've been ordaining women for over a century. My dad is a Methodist preacher, so I know that. And there was a woman ordained, an older woman, who was super smart. Like, she was way more qualified than the guys. And she only got these small churches in farm communities. You know, with her ability, she should have been in a major Methodist church, but fine, whatever. So the idea that if you think, you know, if you believe that people have to, there's a struggle between good and evil, there's a final judgment day, whatever, then you have to think women were given reason. Because that's what you have to use in order to avoid temptation, right? Otherwise, there's this really malicious God who creates half of humanity. Aha, they're going to go to hell. I set them up for it. Ha, you know, just like, that makes no sense at all, right? So she's just like throwing this in your face. You guys. This is crazy. It's not internally consistent at all. So we have to have this power to generalize ideas. And that's what this class is about. Obviously, I'm looking at these patterns. We're looking at these patterns so that you're stepping into history and you can see people making similar mistakes, similarity and difference. And you're starting to use your reason, right? But if you discriminate against women in education, then they're not going to be able to, you know, live godly lives. You also take their power of moral responsibility. Let's see. So if that's true, then every society that denied women education is unjust. And it starts from childhood. Kids start learning habits, but wives and mothers who are educated and who use their reason are better wives, they're better mothers, they're better citizens, they're better religious participants, right? These arguments are still true. That's why I quoted from her. Then I quoted from Martha Nussbaum. She agrees. It's a lot of the same stuff going on. The notion of modesty. There's a double standard. Why do women get blamed? Well, she was wearing the wrong clothes, right? It's her fault. So, okay, that is the main thing. Those are, you know, I think you probably got the main points. There were a couple, I guess I did want to read toward the end. of the paper. There were a couple of pages I sort of picked out that I thought had some. So every time, all right. Okay. So the Constitution of Civil Governments puts all these obstacles in the way to prevent the cultivation of female reason, yet virtue can be built on no other foundation, right? So you've created, the whole structure is unjust. And then page 8. So this is where recently with Black Lives Matter, we were, the expression coming up was systemic racism. Okay, and we'll get to that next time. But right now we're talking about systemic sexism. So what I want you to think about is how it's systemic. It's not just, why can't you stand up for yourself? Or, you know, some little thing. No, it's systemic. So on the one hand, Wollstonecraft describes the power of the external environment. On the other hand, every time a little girl is born, she figures out she's not really, she doesn't deserve this kind of treatment. So when there is an injustice, when a society is based on a lie, right? It creates instability. It's a thorn in the side of a society, no matter how, you know, extreme the social conditioning is. And then it, if a society really wants to flourish as a whole, it really has to change. And of course, those changes often lead to a lot of disruption. But in the end, a society needs to be based on truth. And then right toward the end, the idea of careful examination of the difference between a religion that reinforces reason and anti-intellectual religion. This goes back to traditional liberal arts education, the union of reason and faith. So I did want to point out a lot of feminists tend to be atheists. You know, they think religion is the problem. But when I teach my classes, you know, I always let people, let students decide for themselves. There's two sides to that. Religions don't have to be anti, they don't have to be sexist, but they often are, right? So power of reason is able to recognize its own fallibility, right? That was Socrates, know thyself, don't think you know more than you know. And then passing on to posterity the ideas that would educate the next generation and try to change this stuff. So thinking about it is good, writing about it, passing something forward, paying forward. So theoretical thought isn't everything, right? It has to be instantiated through practical wisdom, like Jason was quoting that it's hard, you know, to take a good idea and figure out how to implement it. But on the other hand, you do need that theory as your guide. So that was how I concluded the paper. Now, here's the next part. Yeah, we do have time. So this is an example of what I would call a great book. The Subjection of Women. And the reason it's great is that you can take the outline of the book and these patterns, he's been able to articulate patterns that just keep reoccurring over and over. Not necessarily, so next time we're gonna take this same outline and apply it to racism, right? So we keep making the same mistake. And the purpose of education, though, isn't for you to be fatalistic. It's for you to be able to say, it is really important that I don't make this mistake because people knew about this thousands of years ago. We don't have to make this mistake. So that's why, you know, education is the only way to avoid making the same mistakes. If we don't become consciously aware of it and then decide we're going to act on reason, not on emotions, not on imitating what other people do, not on, you know, these other motives, we're just going to keep falling back. But we do have this capacity. We don't have to be stupid. We can be wise. We can avoid this, all this suffering, unnecessary suffering. And so that's what we're responsible for doing, whether we're male or female, black or white, you know, whatever. So why is it difficult to prove? Well, feeling. This is a Victorian guy. He's living in the Victorian era. He also is a model of what intellectuals are supposed to do. Like, their place in society is to be visionaries, is to be able to give the reasons, give good arguments for why we need to change. Because people are afraid of change. But the situation is constantly changing. So when people are afraid of change, they don't adapt to the world around them, and they get more and more dysfunctional, and they suffer more and more. So you've got to take your reason, figure out what does change and what doesn't change, and figure out how to apply the patterns that are the same to the circumstances. For example, in order to create a middle class, we have to do different things than we used to do. For healthcare did not used to cost that much because we didn't have as many therapies, right? And so because of our science and our medicine and all these advancements, it costs more. Well, what are you going to do? Are you going to just let the rich have it and everybody else, you know, not be cared for? Or are you going to figure out how to change, right? How to have a higher percentage of healthcare being universal and paid for by taxes? We also have these problems of unnecessary healthcare. What happens when greed drives healthcare? So there's a constant change, right? The need to be healthy is the same. The way the society deals with that need is constantly changing. And a person with practical wisdom figures out what sort of policies, laws, institutions, applications, etc., are going to most likely to create the healthiest people over time, right? So with this, he's arguing that we really need to treat women equally. This is the most radical suggestion you could ever make, because it's more than half the population, right? It's radical. It would require changing everything. Okay, so he's got a tough road, right, to try and argue, defend this position. I hope you can feel, you know, all the resistance he was up against, so that you know, you can read it in light of that. It's, and then I'm going to ask each of you, right, what were some of your favorite arguments? It's mostly people have opinions based on feeling. Their feelings are the opposite of what, if they were using their heads, they would know. Social institutions, people are unwilling to re-examine. And he's saying, as the world moves forward, we're getting greater and greater freedom and equality. And for men, they assume that that's the direction to go. So why not for women, right? I shouldn't have to be arguing for this. You know, this should just come with the turf. No, absolutely. So the burden of proof is on me. You know, I'm not happy about it, but okay, I'll do it. It's difficult to prove a negative, and that's really important. How do you argue that that this is wrong, right? You got to create a different vision. You've got to base it on as much empirical data as you can, even though you haven't observed anything. Like the thing that's driving you is, once again, an idea, a conception of the good based on what you know, but conjecturing, speculating about the future. We're literally, in the realm of human affairs, we truly create a cultural reality. But we don't create all of reality, right? We create a cultural reality that either is based on natural truth or it's not. Romanticism, right? Oh, the French, je ne sais quoi, you know, women, they're just different, it's very mystical. Yeah, and the average Frenchman has 7 partners. It's like more than any other average in the world. Okay, religion, you know, has always been used to reinforce sexism. We don't have knowledge. So he was right at the beginning of social science research. Why is it important? All right, so he's trying to use empiricist methods. He's an empirical science. In the sciences, if you want to prove a hypothesis, you have to have your control group, right? And then your whatever you're testing, right? And he says, we've never had a control group. Okay, here's a society with male domination. Here's a society with female domination. Here's an egalitarian society. Let's see which one works, right? We've never had that. So basically, since nothing else has been tried, it's just might makes right. You know, men were born into this society that gave them the advantage and they're just not gonna let go of it. Someone needs to blow the whistle. Okay, so when people say, but women accept it. Wait a sec, not all of them do. No oppressed class begins by asking for a complete change. They begin by asking for the oppressor. They start out comparing their husbands, which ones are the worst. Okay, so they never begin by complaining about the power itself, but the way it's exercised. Second reason, they're afraid to complain, right? They have to live with their husbands. Who's gonna, you know, publicly complain about their husband and then go home and have to have sex with them? I mean, really? So it's amazing that any women do complain, right? Because even if single women complained, that would make them unmarriable in a society where that's their only way to survive. So it took women a whole lot of courage to complain. They were risking their future. Okay, so in no other case except a child is the person who's suffered has to go back, right back under the power of the person who inflicted the suffering. So his claim is all the causes make it very unlikely that they be rebellious. Men don't want a forced slave, they want a willing one. All the institutions try to enslave women's minds. There's a natural attraction combined with women's dependency. But history always teaches that people held false beliefs. They eventually get exposed. Someone has to be the messenger. We're moving from ancient to modern. People are free and equal individuals. We want minimal laws about what business people go in. So we should have minimal laws about what people can and can't do. People should have free choice. The importance of free and open discussion. Once again, we're back to that liberal arts stuff. Dr. Beck, you just can't get over it. Keeps coming in. Okay. Experience can't be evidence. We don't have experience of equal society. Social reform. Nobody really knows the nature of the sexes because they're all playing roles. People's characters are distorted. Very few men even know the characters of their own wives because they don't know how much they're just reliving all these artificial habits, right? Very few people know themselves or anyone else very well. And then when the society structures all this stuff, it gets worse. The policies are inherently contradictory. Well, what do you think of this reason? If women really were meant to be wives and mothers, why are you preventing? Just give them every opportunity and they'll just be wives and mothers. By forcing them to do it, you're really exposing the fact that it isn't the only option for them. They would choose other things, and they would do it well. And the more you force this, the more obvious it is that it's unjust. Okay, then he says, if marriage is the only alternative, you should at least make it pleasant. And they don't, right? The laws, the system is horrible. It's, men have absolute despotic power over their wives. I don't want to just read this stuff, but that's the way it was. When people are given power, they'll abuse it. That's the whole idea of becoming more democratic. Even in happy marriages, women will be ambitious for their husbands. Their husbands will get in over their head. The society suffers when people have their egos invested in something other than just cultivating their talents and exercising it for the well-being of people who need it. Family life should be based on equality, not despotism. But John Stuart Mill thought women should choose between a career and family. And there is not one country in the world where women don't pay a price for trying to juggle. Norway is about the best, but still, it's impossible even now for women to be able to have a standard getting married, having a couple kids, and having a career without any setback. Doesn't happen. Maybe partly because she doesn't want to spend that much time in the office, but why does she have to? who puts people in these straitjackets, right? So my personal big thing is that given a lot of couples are gonna work from age 25 to 75, right? 50 years, like between the two of them, 100 years of work. Couldn't the system set up so that during those 15 years when they have a couple kids, somebody could work 3/4 time, or both of them could? Like, this is insane. So laws never improved, how social change occurs, philosophy and religion, how they get corrupted, etc. All right, so gonna clock in. Everybody has to clock in. Does anybody want to start?
I'll go.
Okay.
I have a list of just a few that I thought were really important. One was men can force women sexually, no legal limitations or something. That one set me off. And then a few more. Women's character are too distorted by their dependence on their husband. I've pushed myself to be very independent my whole life because of reasons like this. Rape and women not being able to get out of it fast enough, so they have to stay in it and stay silent because of that. And then also think of now, like, all the women, like, I've seen in TV shows and movies and stuff that, like, go on the run because of this reason. And I brought up religion already, but that was also another big one. I have a list I could go down, but we don't have that much time, so I'll let other people go.
Did it surprise you that it's that, you know, some things change and some things don't?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, and the one other thing is that, do you think rape in marriage is illegal in the U.S. or not? Can a woman take her husband to court for rape?
I think she should be able to, but I don't really know.
Well, actually, it was passed in 94, but 38 states have amnesty. In other words, in 38 states, you basically can't. All right. So who's next? Anybody else want to go? Okay, Caitlin, now we're doing women first.
Yeah, I just wanted to go ahead and go because the ones that Mary Hannah just said was the exact ones that I had wrote down. So it was exactly the same.
So go ahead, just the rape and the forcing. Go ahead.
Yeah, that one, and then the characters distorted because of forced dependence, because I also have always been really independent, and that's something I make sure that, like, I don't want to depend on a man for anything ever. So that one stuck out to me.
Yeah, when I first started teaching, you know, that was, women never said stuff like that. That's a big change. But the trouble is, again, when you have kids and you get forced into situations where you have to be away from home a lot, if you try to cut back, you become dependent, right? And that happens quite a bit to women.
Yeah, and also it's not like I say, I don't want to be dependent. I just don't want to have to depend on him for things that I could do myself. Like, I think it's important in like a relationship to be able to depend on like your husband for certain things, but just like, it's just different circumstances. Like, I don't want to depend on him for like money or like something like that. But like in raising kids, like, yeah, I want to be able to depend on him to raise my kids, but just different circumstances.
Okay, good. So Akaya, go ahead.
So I agree with Mary Hannah and Caitlin, but I've put down some more points. So what stuck out to me also, not only what they said, but male domination and how women accept it. And it talked about like abusive marriages and stuff. I just feel like maybe it's not the fact that the women are afraid to complain. It may be just the fact that they're scared to like be alone because they might not have experienced love at like growing up. So like the slight love that their husband is giving them, they're like, oh, this is satisfying to me, even though he is abusive to me. And then I put down the family life should be based on sympathy, not despoticism, because you don't want your kids to grow up and rebel against you. Instead, you want your kids to be able to grow up and come to you and talk to you about anything. So if your kid is doing something bad, you want to be able to tell them this is bad because, or this is wrong because, not just like yelling and, you know, cursing and stuff like that. So,
right. Again, we're going back to reason, right? But that when the kid behaves, you can identify the pattern and you can explain to them the pattern. And then that other thing is women are raised to seek the validation of men, right? And so they want to stay married because it's validation. Does that make sense? And then if you say, well, how come you're so needy? How come you need this validation? Well, you're raised to need it, like the whole system set up to need it, right? And then when people will criticize a woman for staying in an abusive relationship, but like that was how she was conditioned. So that happens. Any kind of oppression is like that. All right, that's good. Okay, guys, which one of you wants to start? Any of you want to start?
I guess I'll start it off again. Okay. So, I don't know. I don't really think it's true when they say that women just accept things. I feel like it's more that they don't have a choice rather than accept it. Because even if you talk in a historical perspective, I feel like if you were to ask them to make a choice between being a stay-at-home wife or going to college and getting an education and making their own money, I just have a hard time believing that the majority of women would choose to be stay-at-home and completely dependent on someone else.
Well, there was a time when that was true because they couldn't even imagine it. I think at this point in history, though, that's true. Yeah, I mean, there was a time when people thought that single mothers, right? Their kids are going to grow up to be like serial killers. This is going to be awful. Or if you have full-time daycare. Oh yeah, when my kids were little, I have a 47-year-old, right? And there was no full-time daycare. There wasn't even daycare. And it was just, whoa. And so people fear what they don't understand. And, you know, for a while there were kids from single households that would, their comments would be, that's not true, right? I mean, kids from single parent households can be fine, i.e. me, right? And so people are able to make better distinctions, right? So this goes back, Jason, to the practical wisdom, right? So in general, perhaps a stable household, yeah, with a mom and a dad that love each other, sure, of course. But what do you do in particular situations, right? Jason, does this make sense that I'm using that, right? Well, it depends on this, it depends on that. It depends on all these things and if they get this or that, right? So that's the difference, and that's what takes effort. It takes thoughtfulness. Okay, Jason, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm unlike the same boat as Titus. I don't think they necessarily accept it. Women accept that the circumstance they're in. It's just they don't really have a choice. It's not an alternative to whatever it is that the option they're given, like, kind of brings up like arranged marriages. Like, for I don't know, the way I see it, for the male is, I don't think it's a problem for them, but for, I think it's for the woman. They see, like, you know, most of the time the girl doesn't want to be in that said marriage. The parents set it up, you know, the male, he probably comes from like economically sound background, you know, he knows what he's doing, this and that. But that's, what if that's not what the, you know, the girl is looking for? So like the marriage is arranged and there's no alternative for them, you know, if they back out of it, or, you know, they tell their parents no, and the parents are going to do it anyways. You know, there's another fallback. It's like, for in some cultures or some places, it brings disgrace or dishonor to the family.
Actually, I could tell you stories about my students from Asia University. Maybe I will tomorrow. It's amazing. Okay, so Lekesny.
My point kind of also kind of pivoted off of Titus's point, because with women, kind of like the old-fashioned way, women was the family, always stayed at home type. And, I'm sorry, she came in and all my thoughts just went away. She interrupted. But I can also do the,
That's okay. Next time, I'll get you next time, okay?
Yes, Ma.
And then Michael.
Yeah, so I there wasn't a lot here that I was like surprised to read, so to speak. I mean, I feel like, I don't know. But one of the things was when it was talking about women's policies being contradictory. I thought that was interesting. But that was probably the biggest thing that I picked up on, just because I do feel like some of the other points I feel like are more recognizable and we see them more often, but that I hadn't.
Okay, so I guess the only thing that surprised me when I wrote this was how many patterns there are, right? Like 40. You know, that was the thing that really shocked me. But anyway, I gotta let you go. It's time to go. So I'll see you tomorrow, and I'll post, right? If I haven't yet tweaked it, you should be able to see, you know, what the reading is for tomorrow. But I plan to do it right now. So okay, take care, guys. Is the pre-video helping at all, or is it just it helps. It sort of eases you into it. Okay. Okay. We'll see you. Bye-bye.